Hallelujah. We give you praise and we give you honor, Lord. Hallelujah, for you are good. In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. You may be seated in his presence. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. It's always such a joy to be here. Amen. We started out since 5 o'clock. This is good. And God's word continued to grow and prevail. As the Bible says, mightily grew the word of God and prevail. And I believe that as we position ourselves, and I would like to say this, because sometimes we do not understand the power of God's word. I mean, because of course, there's creative power in the word of God. Whatever God wants to create, he speaks it. He speaks it. And so he gives us that word. And it's that word, by that word, that we can live an overcoming life. Amen. Amen. For the word of God is what? Quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. And so tonight, as we look into the word of God, I hope tonight we will garner, there will be revelation of the word of God to us. Amen? Amen. Because whatever is revealed to us will change us. As Jesus said to Peter, he says, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. And upon that confession, I will build my church. Amen. Could you imagine? Upon a declaration of the word and the person of Jesus, God says, I'm building my church. Amen. So there's a lot of things God wants to establish and build, and it has to be built on the word, the revealed word of God. Amen? All right, so tonight I want to just talk to you for a brief moment on divine connection, walking in divine favor. Divine connection and walking in divine favor. And I found out that it is, a lot of times we declare and we claim the favor of God, and we want to walk in God's favor, because to be truly successful in ministry and life, let me say this, to be truly successful in ministry and life, you need the favor of God. And favor is not something you necessarily work for or earn, but it is given out of grace. It is given out of grace, right? And we got to understand why our connection with God affords us favor. One of the things I found out is that, and those of you who know the scripture in Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5, where God spoke to Jeremiah, because Jeremiah was kind of timid concerning what God wanted to do in his life, and God had to speak to him. He says, Jeremiah, before you were born, I knew you. Before you were born. That means God knew me before I knew myself. God knew me before I even existed on a tangible basis on the earth. God knew me. So therefore, I'm not an afterthought. My revelation and my manifestation on the earth was not a coincidence. Before I was formed, before I came, God knew me. And he says, while you were in your mother's womb, I ordained you to be a prophet. And I found out something. The old King James used a word. He says, I sanctify you. I sanctify you. While you were in your mother's womb, I sanctify you. And the word sanctify means to set aside for a particular use, or a sacred, non-secular use, right? I set you aside for that. But when did he do it? Did he do it when I walked to an altar? Did he do it when I came and said, Lord Jesus, I accept you as Lord and Savior of my life? No. He did it even before I came out of the womb. God separated me. No, we got to understand that understanding. You got to understand that, look here, I am not an accident. I'm not a coincidence. I was ordained to be what I am walking in now, even before I was born. So what God did was that He preempted anything the devil would have brought. So the devil is late concerning my life. He is late concerning my life. Because before He even knew me, before I was manifested, I was already known by God, ordained by God to be. That's why I always say, I did not come here to find an assignment. I came because of an assignment. There's a difference. I didn't come here to find one. I came because God wanted this. He released me on the earth. All right, we're going somewhere. He released me on the earth. And I found out in the scripture that whatever God forms, creates, ordered, before He ever manifests it, He prepares for it. He prepares. Do you remember when God wanted man? Because the whole creation was about man. The whole creation was about man. The whole creation was about man. So before God manifested man, what did He do? He put everything in order. He says, let there be light. Let the firmament leave the earth and the sky go back where it's supposed to be. Let all the trees and all those things come to place, the grass, the fish and the animals and all those things. He brought, and on top of that, what He did? He said, He planted a garden in Eden. That means God says, I'm preparing everything that is necessary for you to function and fulfill the mandate which has been given to you. And the Bible tells us that when all of this, all the preparation was done, then God says, let us make man. He did not make him while the firmament, the sea, the sky and earth was together. He did not make them when there was no trees. He did not make them when there was no fish in the sea. Because of their assignment, what they had to do, these things had to be in place first. Because if they were not in place, how would He rule over them? How would He rule? So therefore, whatever God, the call of God, and the following of God, of the purpose of God in your life, God always prepares everything. He prepares where you would be born. He prepares the parents that you are going to be from. And some of us don't like the parents, and we don't like the place we are in. But God was the one who ordained it, because He knew that within that environment is the environment that has everything you need. Are you listening to me? Everything you need is in that environment. The problem is that we can't see, because all we see is trouble. Nobody knows the trouble I see. You know the song they sing? Nobody knows the trouble I see, because all they see is trouble. And not understanding that every environment that God puts you and births you in, everything you need is there. Because God is a father and He knows how to prepare. That's why David says, I know Him. That's right. He prepareth a table before me in the presence of my enemies. God is that one who prepares. He always prepares for the purpose and the vision that He gives to you. So that gives you the kind of confidence as Paul had. He says, I don't worry. None of these things move me. I am more than a conqueror. In all of these things. Why? Because he understands that the once he is walking in the purpose and the mandate of God, everything is possible. Oh, Jesus. Everything is possible. And we got to understand that in when God, when we're walking in the purpose and the will of God, everything you need is already there, including the enemies. Including, because there are some enemies you are not ordained to fight. Now, let me say it again. I said there are some enemies that you are not ordained to fight. The enemy that you're called out for is the one who is on your path. Because sometimes what happens, the moment we go off the path, the moment we go off the path of the purpose and the will of God, we will confront devils and demons that we can't handle. Are you listening to me? That's why we come under pressure. We come under all kinds of things. And it seems like things are not working. But if you are in the will of God, any enemy that comes, you can tread upon them. You can tread upon them. Because they are on your path. That's why Jesus said, you shall tread upon lions and copper and adder. Why? Because you tread. Treading means your feet walking on them. That means any enemy that is on the path of that God ordained for me, I have the right to walk upon them. That's why he said, behold, I give you power over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall hurt you. What? If you're in the will and the purpose of God for your life, walking in obedience to it, there's no devil that can ever overcome you. Doesn't mean that he will test you, but they will overcome you. Are you listening to me? Because you have the right of passage. You have the right of passage. Because on that road, God prepares everything. And I'm going somewhere. Prepares everything. Because you are connected to the purpose of God for your life. You're walking it. Therefore, favor becomes natural. Amen. Let me say it again. I said favor becomes natural. Because God has to provide for his purpose. Always for his purpose. I said he has to provide for his purpose all the time. Has to. He has never failed and he will never fail, because whatever he ordains, he has to sustain. Anybody here with me? All right. So when we look at the life of Joseph, which I'm going to use as the core, right? When we look at the life of Joseph, we found out with the life of Joseph that you don't have to be the first to walk in the favor of God. What you need to do is to understand the purposes of God for your life. Because when you walk in the purpose of God, things happen to you and people wonder why you. Because you don't fit the profile. You don't have the background. You are not supposed to be according to men's judgment concerning you, and yet you are excelling, and they wonder why. Because favor is not fair in the eyes of those who don't understand God. I said favor is not fair. It's not fair. But this favor is driven by God's providence for his purpose in your life. Listen to me. That's why it doesn't matter where you come from, who you are, or what your last name is, or the condition of your community. If you're walking in God's will for your life, everything that you need is already given to you. It's not going to be given. It is already given. The problem is that we can't see it, and what we can't see, we can't claim. Are you listening to me tonight? Are you listening to me? Right? So God gives us, and he does that because he knows what is necessary for you to have to accomplish the purpose and plans of God for your life. He knows what you have. And there are some things, there are many things in your life that will come to you. Watch me tonight. That will come to you. And it's not because you work. And you work well. Although that is necessary. Some things will come to you. Not because you fasted 40 days and 40 nights. Some things will come to you. Not because you come to church every Wednesday night and every Sunday. Some things will come to you because you are in the will of God. Oh, you're not listening. You are in the will of God. That's why Jesus said, my food. That means one of the primary desire of men. You know, is food, right? One of the primary desires is of men is food. And food is something you can't do without. He says, my food, I can't do without it, is to do the will of the Father who sent me. And I have to do it while it is day. For the night comes when no man can work. It is my desire. And I know in that place, I have everything. That's why Jesus never was worried about anything. Right, let me say that again. He was not worried about anything because he knew he had everything. So when Peter came to him and said one day, you know, he said, those guys who's in authority is asking about the tax. He said, by right, you know, we're not supposed to. We are citizens of your country. We're not supposed to. But just not to offend anybody. I got to put up someplace. So Peter, you just take your hook and go over to the sea and just throw it there, because my bank account is in the mouth of a fish. Oh, God Almighty. I'm telling you, God, that is why when walking in the will, you will begin to see things that other people don't see and know things that other people don't know that gives you the advantage in life. It gives you the advantage in life. So that they may never ask you, where is your God? Because your God is in demonstration in your life. Right. You know what is the scripture that in Luke chapter 11 that blessed me from my teens, just bless me. Jesus said, if your earthly father, being evil, know how to give what? Good gifts. There's no good father would ever give something terrible to their children. No good father. You want to be protective. You want to, you know, make sure it looks. I mean, there are times when I go places and my daughter don't have to ask me to go back. I look and I see something that would fit her, look good on her. I'll buy it without her even asking me. Because I know how to give good gifts. If you understand. And he says, if you being evil, know how to give good gifts. Much more me, the Heavenly Father. Where there's no variableness, there's no shadow of turning with me. I am perfect in all my ways. I am constant and consistent. There's no shadiness about me. What I say, I mean it. Because God is predictable. Not unpredictable. You know, some people want to think that God is very unpredictable. We're not sure. No, God is. That's why whatever He says is what He means. If I can't believe your word, you are not predictable. Because I don't know what you're going to do. Oh, you're not hearing me. I don't know what you're going to do. But my Father, I know what He's going to do. Because my Father said, if I ask anything in the name of Jesus, He will do it. I know He will do it. Oh, God. He is predictable. So, because he is, he will always provide. So, therefore, he will open doors, do things in our life, not because he wants to make us the star of the world. But it has to do with his purpose and his will. Are you listening to me? That his kingdom may come. and his will may be done on earth as it is in heaven. That when I carry out this will, the heavens and the Father will be glorified. Of course, you know what the word glory means. That means glory means to show off. Is the weight of a thing. The weight. The influence. The brilliance of a thing. Right? He says, I want to be glorified. That means God is shown off. Just like when the Bible talks about, you know, the first miracle of Cana of Galilee in John, St. John chapter 2. He talks about the miracle of the turning of the water into wine. What an awesome miracle.
That's right.
But the scripture says, this began to show the glory. Glory, simply, glory. If there is no result, there is no glory. All right, let me say that again. There's no result, there is no glory. Result is what shows the glory of a thing. Are you listening to me? And God says, I want to show off my glory upon you. That is why God provides for you. That is why God's open doors and divine intervention in your life, miracles, and he lets your word be with authority and power. All of that he's doing so that his name will be glorified. And that will come to you when you are walking in the will of God for your life. There is no lack in the will of God for your life. Because sometimes it seems like some things is delayed, but it's never denied. Am I talking to anybody tonight? It might be delayed, but it is never denied. So God spoke to Abraham. He said, Abraham, I'm going to make you the father of what? Many nations. And yet, he didn't see one. Are you listening to me? It took him 25 years. 25 years after that word was spoken to him. Actually, God had to give him a picture of it. He had to give him a picture. Because what you cannot form as a picture in your mind, you cannot understand. What you can form as a picture in your mind, you cannot understand. See, if you never knew about Coca-Cola, and I say Coca-Cola, you could not form a picture in your mind. So you can understand. Are you understanding me? Are you understanding? So the word of God comes to us, and the understanding of what God has for us, we have to have a picture of it. A picture of it. That is why when God speaks to you, thank you. When God speaks to us, he wants us to see. I'm not talking about the natural light. He wants us to see. So what did he do to Abraham? He took him out in the night and he said, Look up to the sky. Look up to the sky. It might be delayed, but it's not denied. He says, look up to the sky. Can you count the stars? And of course, that was a visual thing. A visual thing. So he could see the star. And of course, Abraham said, I wouldn't try. There are too many up there. I won't try. God said, that's the way. Oh God, that's the way your seed is going to be. So every time when Abraham left that scene, every time he was bombarded by doubts or bombarded by people's opinion, he remembered the star. That's how my seed is going to be. That's how it's going to be. Hallelujah. 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 God will always give you a picture of your future. And the picture, you remember what God says to St. Jeremiah 29, verse 7. He says, I know the thoughts I have for you. You cannot formulate thoughts without pictures. Can you think blank? No, I'm asking you. Can you think blank? No, you can't think blank. If you're thinking, you must be thinking of something. No, nobody's not hearing me in this place. You got to be thinking of something. Thinking. That's why the Bible says, as a man, he says, he's able to do far exceedingly abundantly above all that you ask. Or what? Imagine. Think. Think. That's why God wants us to think. It's not the removal of our minds. It's the renewal. Because God wants us to think. And so he had to paint a picture. That's why he had to paint a picture with Joseph. Because anything God ordains, he's going to provide for it. Give your favor like you've... He got to paint a picture. So what God did to Joseph? Joseph went to bed one night. And I'm sure it's not the first time he dreamt. He had a dream. But this night, God painted a picture of his future. Painted a picture of his future. He said, come on, this is what's going to happen. You know, the corn, the sheep, is going to, 11 of them going to bow down to you. Right? And if you notice, Joseph never interpreted. It's the boys who decide what it was. No. I said Joseph never interpreted. Joseph didn't come out and say, I had a dream, and you know the 11 sheaves bow down to me, and this is the interpretation I think it is. The boys, the other brothers, they decided that it must be talking about them. Because when they look around and count themselves, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, we are the one who match up with this 11.
That's right.
They did the interpretation, not him. But what? God painted a picture of future glory in this little boy. What about 17, close to 17 years old? He painted that picture of the future. Why? Why you think that? Because you have to understand, wherever God is taking you, on that road, there is also enemies. Oh God. Things that are going to come against the purposes and the will of God for your life. And if you don't have a picture that is riveted and painted in your mind about what God has for you, you will give up on the way. And don't think because you are 20 and 30 years in church that can happen to you. You can still come to church and give up. No. You can just finish doing a miracle and see God's glory and still give up like Mr. Prophet Elijah. Are you listening to me? Because he substituted another picture for the picture that God painted in his mind. You know, when Jezebel said to him, Jezebel said, man, when he heard that all the 400 prophets were killed and so on, Jezebel said, I'll do to that one tomorrow. Tomorrow his head is not going to be on his body. I'm going to kill him tomorrow. And the Bible says, it's awesome. The Bible says, when he saw, the woman spoke, but he saw. What did he see? He saw his head rolling down Jerusalem Street. Are you listening? He saw his head. The picture he formed now determined his action. Am I talking to anybody here? That's why you got to protect your mind. You got to protect your mind. That's why Peter said, gird up the loins of your mind. Gird it up. You know, gird up like a belt. Like a belt. You know, hold it tight so your pants don't drop off. Let your mind not drop off. Your mind. He says, gird it up. Gird it up. Gird it up. And that's what Elijah never did. He made his mind just flow. And a different picture was substituted in his mind. And the Bible said, he ran for his life. The mighty man who just experienced fire coming down from heaven, sucking up water, burning the sacrifice. I mean, fire from heaven. Fire from heaven. All these prophets around never saw anything like that. Fire from heaven. burning up the sacrifice, mighty, and people were shouting, oh, the Lord God, He's truly God. Yeah, Lord, I'm telling you, you can come to church and say, God is a truly God, He's truly God, and praise Him. But if you change that picture in your mind,
that's right.
Am I talking to anybody here tonight? If you change that picture in your mind, oh, the Bible says that Elijah went down on the broom tree. The broom tree, lying on there. I said, God, this is over. Me alone, and we're dead, you're out of here. I mean, and he fell asleep. And the angel came, and in Jamaica we say, juke him. You know, we say, juke him. He came and juke him, and he jumped up. Amazing, jumped up. The angel spoke to him. The angel had food prepared for him. I'm telling you, the angel of God prepared for him. And the man got up and ate and fell back to sleep. Even a manifestation of God did not change, oh God, did not affect him. He was in such depression. I said he was so depressed by the picture he saw. Let me tell you, the devil will bring pictures in your mind. Pictures of your finances. Pictures of your debt. Pictures of sickness. Picture of the economy. He will bring pictures before you. And if you replace the picture that God has formed on your mind, I'm telling you, you're going to be depressed like the world. You're going to give up. You're going to say all kinds of things and not trust the Lord who called you. So touch your neighbor and say, don't substitute God's picture for any other. Yeah, let it keep it on your mind. Keep it on your mind. Let it be there. Don't be moved by anything you hear or see. Make sure the prevailing picture. Are you hearing me? So when others want to play pictures before you, a movie, you take out your own CD. I'm talking spiritual CD. Take out your own CD, press play, and you look into the perfect law of liberty, which is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless. I'm telling you. Many people are deceived because they're in the church and been here 25 years sometimes. I'm telling you, you can sit in church and you're gone. And that's why God had to paint the picture first. Every time He comes to you, reveal His part, He paints a picture in your mind. And I can tell personally, as a little boy, 15, 16 years old, God painted the picture of what I'm doing today. Are you listening to me? He painted the pictures of nations, of people. Are you listening to me? He painted the picture. So when they were trying times and I seemingly did not know where I'm going, I always go back and play that thing again. Oh, God Almighty. You think Joseph was not playing that thing again in prison? You think he wasn't playing it in the pit? Why you think he never complained? Not at one time did Joseph complain. Neither at any time did Joseph go against his brothers. You watch this. Read the scripture. Not one time he said, oh, you whatever, and curse them out. No, not one time. You read it, not one time. Why? Because that picture was so riveted within me. I said, I may be in the pit now. I may be in the prison, but I got a picture of a palace. I have a picture that at the end I am going to triumph. I got a picture. Oh, God Almighty. Oh, God Almighty. I got a picture. I got the picture. You can't erase that from my mind. You can't erase that from my spirit. Because God has a way of painting it when nobody else is around. Oh, that's why He carries those He used greatly into places of solitude. Moses on the backside of the desert. John in the wilderness. Jesus in the wilderness. Because He wants to paint a picture that is not affected by... will be affected by other people's opinion. Sometimes He has to take you away. Put you in solitude. So He can paint the picture. And then the Bible says, oh, what your age is. He's still in the painting, the picture. Moses was 84 years old. 84. Are you listening to me? Well, could you imagine? Could you imagine? From a little child, you were called and mother talked to you about, you know, your special child and how all of that. It took 84 years. God had to take him to the backside. You know why? Because Egypt had painted a picture that did not line up. Oh, God. So God had to take him out of the place, put him in a place, and deprogram him. Erase. Oh, you're not hearing me. Erase. 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 You know, sometimes you draw a picture, and when you look at it, it doesn't fit the way you are thinking. So you would what? Erase it. Are you listening to me? Because you have to understand, oh, God did this erasing. God took him out of the back for 40 years out there in the backside of the mountain. And when Moses went to his father-in-law, he was articulate. He was powerful in speech. How many of you know that? When he was in Egypt, he was powerful in speech. He commanded things in Egypt. He was going to be next in line. Are you listening to me? When God took him out there 40 years, man, he erased it so much that when he came back, he couldn't talk. Oh, you're not hearing me. He could not talk. Because God said, that's not the picture that I have of you from the beginning. That is not the picture. So he had to take him out and rewrite the picture on his mind. So when he left the father-in-law to go and deliver the children of Israel. And I'm telling you, you wouldn't want to pastor that church. You don't want to pastor that church called the children of Israel coming out of Egypt. You don't want to. It's a church. I don't know if you've ever experienced it, but it's a church that they get blessing today and they take tambourine and they say, hallelujah for the Lord God. Yeah, he delivers and they dance and sing. And the next day, they say, kill him. Yeah, kill him. Yeah. Let's get a new leader. We're going back to Egypt. The thing we know. I'm telling you. You better have a picture. You better have that thing imprinted on your mind. You're going to get discouraged. You're going to walk away. But let me tell you, if you stay with the will of God, God opened doors where nobody, man, he'll do things for you. That those who hate you will come around to you. For if your ways please the Lord, even your very enemies will come and be at peace with you. How many people know that? And he has a way of preparing before you, before your enemies, prepare a table. That means the enemy is watching God, bringing favor and deliverance. And all he can do is just to watch God. To watch God bring you through. Watch God supply your needs. Watch God give you power in your word. Watch God. All he could do, just stand and watch. The problem is most of us, our focus is on the enemy and not the table. Yeah. No. Are you listening to me? Because you see, he can't touch you when God is the one preparing and invite you to the table. Nobody can deny you. Nobody can. And David understood that because he was walking in a purpose. God, he had victories after victories after victories. You know what? You know what? The favor of God. That's why many times he says, I didn't win this battle because I was skillful. But the favor of God will open doors. He'll make you be at the right place at the right time. Are you listening to me? And even your enemies is at the right place at the right time to give you the promotion. Because there's no promotion without an enemy. You need an enemy for promotion. I said, you need an enemy. David needed a Goliath. Yes. David. Moses needed a Pharaoh. Are you not listening to me? Yes. They need a Pharaoh. Yes. But because God already around you and release favor and determine favor for your life. He determined it even before you came. For I know the plans I have for you, says God. Plans not to harm you. What is it that plans not to what?
Yeah,
plans not, so any harming that's going on is not God. No. Any hurt, God does not hurt you. He will never hurt you because that belongs to Slewfoot, not God. He says, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So circumstances of life and bad decisions that we make cause things to pressure us. Are you listening to me? But that's why the moment we run back to God, He does what? He delivers us. You know what deliverance is? Deliverance is to take you out of trouble that have confined you and limit you and squeezing your destiny. He takes you out of it. He delivers you and He puts you back right on the path. Deliverance means to take you from here and put you back on the path. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's why you don't have to fret. You don't have to be worried about tomorrow. That's why Jesus said, do not worry about tomorrow. What you shall eat or what you shall put on. Your favor is your portion. I said favor is your portion. If you're walking in the wheel, favor is your portion. Jesus turned up and he says, we have over 5,000 men here. 5,000 men. Not counting children. 5,000 men we got here. We got to hear 5,000 men. And he says, look here, give them to eat. If somebody turns up at your house suddenly, and they turn up with their mother, father, and 8 children, suddenly on you. Suddenly on you. For most of us, we would not be prepared. True or lie? Most of us, we wouldn't be prepared. We wouldn't be prepared. And yet Jesus looked at a circumstance and said, give them to eat. Give the 5,000 hungry belly men who have been with me for 3 days and men 3 days without food.
That's right.
They're on the edge of anger.
No.
Are you listening? 3 days without food. And yet Jesus said, give them to eat. And Johnny, Peter said, Man, if we go and buy, you know, it's still not going to be enough, Jesus. What are you talking about? Jesus, what are you talking about? Jesus, you don't understand. Favor, you don't understand. You don't understand this. What happened? They found one little boy with what? 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And thank God for mothers. Because this woman got a revelation of this Jesus. And this woman knew that if you go to Jesus' church, you don't know when it's going to be over. not like some of our churches. We know it's 1 hour and 45 minutes. And if he ever dare, am I talking to anyone? If he ever dare go over that, I'm gone, baby. Are you listening to me? I'm gone. But if you're in Jesus' church, man, 5 p.m. on the first day, he's just getting started. Are you listening to me? 3 days. And then after 3 days, Jesus said, you know, it's fair enough. We can't feed these people. We can't send them home like this. We can't feed them. So he said, give them to him. And this woman knew that. This woman, you know, women have some insight that men don't have. You know, we just go and whatever. You know, but women kind of, you know, think about it and say, if I'm going for 3 days, and we know how Jesus preached, he may preach for 1 day, but you never know. He might go 2, he might go 3. So my little son, I know you're excited about Jesus. You want to go to see Jesus. He never said that the mother was with him, but he was so confident about this Jesus. He said, but I'm going to fix you something. Just in case he preaches 3 days. Just in case he preaches 3 days. And thank God. Oh, God. She prepared and positioned herself to walk in favor. Many times we don't talk about that little boy's mother. We only see the little boy. Oh, you're not here. Are you leaving me only the little boy? But you got to consider that mother that prepared that little boy. And the Bible says that little boy was so excited. To give his lunch, because if the boy was one of those English boys. I'm telling you, I got only 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And look at all those. This can't do anything to them. They should have brought their own. Let them go and buy. Where you come from? The boy willingly gave Jesus. Watch this. Give Jesus. Jesus took the bread of the hand and blessed it and broke it. When you actually in origin is that the bread, in essence, each disciple did not get a piece. They got a whole. They got a whole. Because when they served it, each person had enough. Are you listening? Had enough that they could, some translations say crumbs, but it's not really crumbs. You know crumbs? You know what's crumbs? Yeah, crumbs, you don't really take up crumbs. You don't really take up crumbs? No, you don't take up crumbs. It was such a large portion that it was placed in baskets. Are you listening? Large portion that it was placed in baskets. And theologian tells us that the 12 basket was given to the boy. Oh, yeah. Could you imagine that mother? When he came, probably the boy had to get some donkeys or something to get. Could you imagine the mother? My Lord, the favor of God. This morning I didn't wake up, oh God, not having 12 baskets of bread, but look at what God has done. Oh God. That's why David says in Psalm 116 and verse 7, he says, return to your rest, O my soul, for God has been good to you. His favor is upon your life because you walk in his purpose and his destiny. God will never leave you nor forsake you. He will provide thoroughly for you. And I'm not just talking about physical things. I'm telling you, he'll provide wisdom for you. Now, no man will be able to outwit you. Are you listening to me? Because he will provide for his purpose. He will bring success to you in your life. And you don't have to be young. Some people say, well, you know, kind of old now. I'm past the age. But let me remind you of Moses. You remember that guy who said, give me that mountain? How old was he? 85 years old. And he says, give me that mountain. He said, I don't want a plane. I want a mountain. Oh, God Almighty. Because I know the favor of God. I can see the will of God for my life. And if I go to that mountain, I'll have the strength to go there. I'll have the strength to conquer it. I'll have the strength to build a city. I have the strength. Why? Because God will open doors for me. And, oh God, make ways that be no way. He will make men come and ask, what shall we do to be saved?
That's right.
Without having to have a big old crusade. If you understand me, the favor of God.
That's right.
But it's divinely connected to God's purpose. Walking in God's purpose for your life. And that's one of the things we need to discover more than anything else. Why am I in this church? What's my true role? Not just a role somebody gave to you. What was I caught up before I was born? And I'm passionate about it because I've seen so many people go through life and never truly fulfill. And they wonder why favor and all the things have not come to their lives. But it's in the place of the will of God. God will make some things effortless when you're in the will. What did he say? He says, my yoke is easy. My yoke is easy. You know that's a paradox. Because there's no yoke that is easy. In essence, in your eyes and my eyes, there's no yoke that is easy. Because you don't mean to be tied to something else. And you cannot truly determine your direction. You're always depending on the other. There's no yoke that is easy. And he says, my burden is light. That's paradoxical. There's no, the mere fact that it's a burden, it speaks of weight. Are you listening? It speaks of weight. It speaks of something that weighs you down. But he says, my burden is light. He says, if you do my will, it will not burden you down. Oh God, it will lift you if you do my will. Even when arrows are coming from different directions in your life, he says, it will just be quenched. Nah. Ephesians 6, it will be quenched. Because you have the picture. You have your shield of faith. Are you listening to me? Because you believe what God has said. It will quench every fiery dart of the enemy. I want to encourage you tonight. If you're divinely connected to God, everything you need to fulfill, and maybe some of us, the God has put pictures and dreams in our hearts from the past, and some of us have not seen it fulfill in our life, and we're saying, oh, I'm gone too far now, I'm too old, it's not going to happen. I want to tell you, he's the resurrection and the life. Are you listening to me? He can come back because there are people who are waiting on you, people who are still waiting on you. Oh, God Almighty. The only reason why some of us is not dead yet is God is still waiting. No, you're not listening. I said God is still waiting. I'm telling you, the reason why some of us is not dead yet is God still waiting. God's still waiting. How long am I going to let him wait? How long am I going to let him wait? That's why he's called the Redeemer. Because sometimes how many of you know that God can wait? But the question is, how long you're going to make him wait? How long you're going to make him wait? There's some people that need. There's some things that need to happen in the spirit realm that is waiting on you. And God says, "I'll give you everything you need: the strength, the power, the resources, everything you need. I'll give them. I'll open doors that will surprise your very enemy, because I am God. I am God." Oh, God Almighty. Sometimes we sometimes make him look like he's just trying to be God. You know, he looks like he's trying to be God. God is not trying to be God. He's God. Hello? He's God. And he wants to show off big time. He's God. And he wants to come and say, I am God. And beside me, there is none other. None can do like I do. None can be like I be. He said, that's why he said, you are my witnesses that I am God. That means you must testify. You must say what the Lord has done. That means he must be doing something. He must be in motion in your life that you can say to others, look what the Lord has done. Witnesses. You can only be a witness if you have heard something or seen something. Are you listening? That means that God wants you to see something so you can be that witness. Yeah. Oh, God Almighty. Oh, God Almighty. So that Jesus can be glorified. Distinction. Are you listening to me? A distinction.
Hallelujah.
And I believe the time is now.
Oh, yes.
So if I walk in the will, you want to walk in the will. Not my will, Lord, but thine. Before time be gone, you have for my life. I'm going to walk. I'm telling you, if you even think you've missed it, if you think you've missed it in the past, I want to tell you, God is a restorer. He will restore. And what he can do in 2 years, you couldn't do it in your lifetime before. Are you listening to me? Because one drop of God's favor is worth a lifetime of labor. That's why favor is already ordained for your life. You think God knew that you were going to mess it up. God knew that you were going to mess it up. That's why he provides favor a long time for your life. Am I talking to anybody in this place? Hallelujah. That's what gives hope. That's what gives confidence that I can rest in this God. That as long as I'm falling after me, I do not have to worry. Do not worry what you shall eat, what you shall drink, what you shall put on. For your heavenly Father already knows.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Amen.
He knows, man. He knows.
Come on, lift your hands to him tonight. Come on, lift your hands to that God and begin to thank him. Come on, begin to thank him tonight. Begin to thank him. Come on, begin to thank him. Begin to thank him for his preordained favor on your life. You're not a mistake. You're not just going through the motion. Some of you have labored for 25, 30 years. Yeah. God is not through with you yet. He has not parked you somewhere and for you to dry out. No. Actually, the rest of your life is going to be the best of your life. Oh, God, it became better for Moses at 84. Better for Caleb at 85 years old. Better for him. And it doesn't matter where you are. The purposes of God, God will provide for you, and use you in ways that you never dreamt of. That people will marvel that at your age, his power and glory is in your life. Oh, am I talking to anybody else tonight? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Until you close your eyes in death. Let the world know that there is a God in this church. Let the world know that the miracle church here is not here to take up space, but to show forth the praises of him who has called us from a world of darkness into this marvelous life. Father, tonight we give your glory. Tonight we give your praise. Tonight we give your honor, Lord. Oh, tonight we lift you up, mighty God of heaven. I thank you for your church. I thank you for your people. I thank you that you're about to show off even in this place, God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I pray that every prayer, every fasting, everything that has happened in this church, I call for the fruit. I call for the harvest in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, that there will be a tangible demonstration of the power of the living Christ in this place, in this city. Oh, God Almighty. Oh, it doesn't matter. People say, that England has backslidden from God. But Lord God, the earth is yours and the fullness thereof. And you promise that the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of God as the waters cover the sea. I declare in this place, in the name of Jesus, that there will be a breaking forth on the right, the left. Oh God, there will be a pouring out like we have never seen before. Heko moshata karabasaya. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Come on, take 25 seconds and praise him like you've never praised him before. Come on, take it. Hallelujah. Praise me that I have received. I have received. Thanksgiving me that I have received. God, I receive from you tonight. I receive from you. Thank you, God. I'm walking in your favor. I'm walking in your favor. And favor will show you are. Favor will show that who you are. Favor will show up. Oh, God, the sinners will never say, where is your God? But they will see him at work. And they will be led to glorify the Father who is in heaven. That they will bow their knees to the Lordship of Jesus. And say, what shall we do to be saved? What shall we do to be like you? Any lukewarmness, we come against it in the name of the Lord Jesus. Any place that have been still and there's no growth, no development, God, I thank you, God, for stirring that place again. Oh, God, breaking up the fallow ground, breaking up the places again. Hallelujah. Bring your rain, oh, God, that seeds may germinate. Hallelujah. Trees may grow up and fruit may be produced in the name of Jesus, that the nation will come and partake of what you're doing, God. Echo mostata, ta.
I release every Moses in this house. I release every Moses. Moses that have been comfortable. Oh, in places that he never called to. I command you to rise up to the will and purposes of God for your life. We give you praise. 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 Come on, give him praise. Come on, give him praise. Stand on your feet and give him praise. Come on. Kurobo tata man de meshata. Sedelebo stekata na 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 ma. Come on. Give him praise. Because something is breaking tonight. An unleashing is happening. In the name of the Lord Jesus. A fresh anointing. A fresh release upon your life. A fresh new day. Oh, some of you are going to see some things that you have not seen for years. Some things that have been buried. Some giftings that have been lying dormant. The Holy Ghost is calling them to come forth in the name of the Lord Jesus. For you are my witnesses, says God. You are my witness that I am God. I am nobody else. Oh, to throw me off on the earth. But you are my witnesses. So therefore I have crowned you with favor, so they may know that I am the Lord.